Hello, my name is Don Sweeney, a member of the Cranford Memorial Day Parade Committee. Back in the early 2000s, as a scout leader, I was inspired by a veteran named Bob Greco that each year would read the names of the World War II fallen heroes after the parade on Memorial Day. He would say something like this: "I will now read the names of the 57 men that our town lost in 4 short years. When I read their names, I will see their faces. You see, these were my friends, my teammates, and my classmates. I knew mostly all of them. You, on the other hand, will just hear names." Hearing that each year made the hair stand up on my forearm. My God, I thought, 57 kids from our high school lost in 4 years? I just couldn't imagine it. That emotion drove me to join the Memorial Day Parade Committee. Then later in 2016, with the help of some dedicated people, we started the Cranford 86 Project. Together, we would start to research the lives of several of these men and write their stories in the Cranford Monthly and on our website at cranford86.org. Now it's taken on to have a life of its own. We hope someday that everyone, like Bob Greco, will see the faces when they hear the names read on Memorial Day morning. Up to last year's parade, we profiled 21 of these hometown heroes. This year, we honored 6 more. But with the parade canceled due to the COVID-19 crisis, we've decided to bring the story summaries to you via TV35. The books that we usually make available at the ceremony are still available and can be delivered to your home. Information is available on our website or by calling the number on the sign behind me or that you might see later in the presentation. I hope that you will honor them by placing our memorial book on your coffee table for all in your household to read. Now, let me introduce to you our first honored hometown hero for 2020. Gunner's Mate Second Class Patrick P. Castaldo from World War II. Patrick Castaldo was a crew member from the legendary USS Indianapolis. If you think you are unfamiliar with the tragic story of the Indianapolis, you may remember it if I was to say that it's the story told by Captain Quint in his soliloquy in Steven Spielberg's movie Jaws. He had his crew on the edge of their seat as they listened, except for the fact that here we're using historic facts instead of non-Hollywood fiction. Now knowing a kid from Cranford was part of that epic tale, we surely have grabbed your attention. Patrick, or Perk, as his family called him, came to Cranford through an interesting way. Up to high school, he lived in Bayonne with his mom and dad, the youngest of 9 of an Italian immigrant family. His father wasn't happy with the crowd he was surrounding himself with, so he asked his eldest son, Neil, if Patrick could live with him in Cranford. Patrick's older brother was Dr. Neil Castaldo. He had just opened his medical practice here in town. He and his wife, Loretta, welcomed Perk into their home, along with their 1-year-old daughter, Patricia. We were lucky enough to be guided through Patrick's life story by Patricia, who spent 4.5 years of her life with him here in Cranford. Patrick served for 2.5 years on the most prestigious ship in the American Navy. Through 9 violent battles, he was wounded in a kamikaze attack. He then met his death in the worst open sea disaster in American history. I oftentimes tried to put myself in this young man's shoes during these events, but it was more than my imagination could handle. If the story were not true, it would seem to be unbelievable. The details are thrilling, extraordinary, and heart-pounding. On its final cruise, the Indianapolis was on a secret mission to deliver Little Boy, the atom bomb that would end World War II. After its delivery, he was put out to prepare for the D-Day landing that was coming up, although a secret mission at that point. On its way, it was struck by 2 torpedoes shot by a Japanese submarine. It was sunk in just 12 minutes. Through a series of errors and miscommunications, they were not rescued for 4.5 days. The book and movie In Harm's Way tell the tales of this well, but our book does a pretty good job as well. As a result of burnings, drownings, hypothermia, and shark attacks, over 800 men perished in the open sea. Of the 1,197 men aboard, only 316 were rescued when help finally arrived. Yes, the worst open sea disaster in American history. A few days later, on August 12th, 2 uniformed sailors arrived at 103 Lincoln Avenue. Young Patricia answered the door. The telegram informed them that Patrick was lost at sea. This was the first news that the family had of the disaster. Dr. Castaldo's wife, Loretta, contacted many of the 316 survivors in search of information about Patrick's last moments. They had hopes that Patrick was still alive, being that he was an excellent swimmer. She was able to find a shipmate that was actually in the water with Patrick. He told of Patrick being severely burned and in much pain and hallucinating. He was reported to have swum off to a mirage of a passing boat, never to be seen again. He was just 20 years old. This is the longest and most exciting story that we've told to date. If you've not read it, I recommend this one highly. Dr. Neil Castaldo maintained a memorial of his little brother in his backyard for his entire life. That memorial is now in the backyard of Patricia in her home in Westfield. Special thanks go out to the family of Patricia Javi Castaldo for sponsoring the banner of Perk, their Uncle Patrick. If you're curious where the nickname Perk came from, then you'll have to read our story. We thank you for listening, and we hope you stay tuned all day for more stories of our Cranford 86 2020 heroes. Thanks again. Hello, my name is Don Sweeney. I'm the coordinator of the Cranford 86 Project. Our mission is to introduce our town's people to the men whose names are engraved in bronze at the memorial at Memorial Park. Every single hero that we featured so far volunteered for service. None waited to be drafted. They believed in causes larger than themselves. They were silent warriors who stepped up when their country called. We can learn a lot from their stories about character and about volunteering for causes that benefit our country, our state, and our town of Cranford. Although every story about Cranford's fallen is unique and fascinating, we have identified one common trait. It's timeless, something you can teach your kids and store for the ages. It's selfless leadership. Now let me introduce to you another one of our Cranford 86 heroes. Sergeant William Lee from World War II. The story of Sergeant William Lee was featured this past February in commemoration of Black History Month. William Lee's grandson, Pastor William Lee III from Georgia, has been in contact with us since we started telling these stories 3 years ago. He was a great help in creating this profile. This year, with some research from Stu Rosenthal, we were able to find some facts that tied Sergeant Lee's life to the civil rights movement that changed the lives of African-American military men and women that have followed his footsteps through the rest of time. William's parents were born right after the conclusion of the Civil War in a tobacco community in Virginia. Born in 1915, William was the youngest of nine children. His mom, Cora, and grandmother, Martha, a former slave, moved to Cranford in 1915. William followed in 1928 when he was 19. He worked as an electrician's helper at first and then as an apprentice tailor at Prestige Cleaners on South Avenue, right through the Depression. Joining the Army in 1929 at 32 years old, possibly for economic reasons, and was stationed at MacDill Air Base in Tampa, Florida, in the Deep South, where Jim Crow laws were prevailing. The military in the 1940s had just started to segregate the races again, an attempt to calm racial unrest. But what really happened was quite the opposite. These situations must have been a shock for William. Cranford at that time was totally integrated. MacDill Airfield became the center of violent racial uprisings, similar to the race riots of the 1960s and 70s. Our research put William Lee right in the middle of the uprisings. Being that he was the highest ranking black soldier as a sergeant, he was a northern soldier, the most outraged, and at age 34, he was one of the oldest soldiers there. So we figure that he was right in the middle of all this and had the leadership qualities that would put him there. What would happen at MacDill Airfield would change the American military forever. Some feel it inspired Congress to activate the famed Tuskegee program, an all-black program that sent 992 African-American airmen into battle over Europe. They were responsible for 260 enemy kills and never lost a bomber. In 1943, William shipped out to England as part of the Radio Corps. Only 1% of radio men were African-American, so this was an impressive appointment. Possibly credited to his skills that he acquired in Cranford as an electrician's helper. While there, he was seriously injured in a camp accident. He was sent home to hospitals in New York and New Jersey for care. Sorry to say, he contracted pneumonia and died while in upstate New York. He was 35 years old and had served for 21 months. Now he's buried in Scotch Plains at Hillside Cemetery, right across the street from Plainfield Country Club. His grandson, William III, was thrilled to receive the picture of his grandfather in uniform that we had at the Cranford Historical Society. He remembers his grandmother showing it to him when he was 10 years in Cranford. Her home was sadly destroyed by fire on Elise Avenue, and that picture was lost in the fire. These short summaries of these men's stories only scratch the surface of the details that we gather and the drama that comes from the entire text. I hope you'll reach out and read their entire story. That's the story of William Lee. We hope you stick around for the rest of the day as more stories from the Cranford 86 will be playing as the day goes on. Thanks for listening. Hi, welcome back. It's Don Sweeney again with another profile of one of our Cranford 86. Let me introduce to you Augustine DeLisandros, or Augie, as his family knew him. He was the ninth of 10 children born to Natalie and Pietrina DeLisandros, Italian immigrants from 10 Meeker Avenue. That's the street right by the Cranford Elks off of Lincoln Avenue, by the senior citizen housing. He was a hometown hero long before his sacrifice in World War II. On the baseball diamond, his performances as an ace pitcher and the reliable slugger were said to have been legendary. His oppressive presence on the offensive line as center on the varsity football team was larger than his 5'8", 175-pound frame would have projected. Augie was physically tough and extremely competitive. On the field, he did everything. In his yearbook, it actually says that Augie actually did gardening in between his roles on the field, sort of a humorous stab at his versatility on the baseball field. Raised in Cranford through the Great Depression, Augie graduated in 1940 and took work at General Motors to fund his hopes for education. College educations weren't handed out on silver platters to Depression kids, especially ones in families of 10 kids or more. So working for his things he wanted was taught to him, and that's what he was doing at General Motors. For a few months there, as an upholsterer on Pontiacs and Oldsmobiles, before it converted into creating the Grumman Wildcats, he was making constructing cockpits for these fighter planes. Eastern Aircraft would in the four-year period create 100,000 fighter planes, and most of them were created here in Linden at the GM plant. He would soon enlist in active duty, and his possessions on the assembly line would be replaced by women. These women were known in history as Rosie the Riveters, and there were many of them on the assembly line in the Linden GM plant. After training in Tennessee and Maryland, Augie shipped out to England with the 9th Infantry, 60th Infantry Regiment, and began an 8-month intense training for a mission that was not known to them. It would be the D-Day invasion, the largest amphibious attack in world history. The Cranford Citizen and Chronicle publicized a meeting on February 25, 1944, of a get-together between Augie and his younger brother, Lewis. The family took comfort about that, as Lewis was their youngest in the family, and everyone was concerned about him. Also in England that day was another brother, Albert. His training responsibilities kept him from the meeting. Roughly 4 months later, all three would be part of the D-Day invasion. Lewis on Omaha Beach within 29th Infantry, Albert into Germany-occupied Normandy in a glider with the 82nd Airborne, and Augie onto Utah Beach with the 9th Army, 60th Infantry Battalion. On June 10th, D-Day plus 4, Augie's unit with four other battalions received their orders. They were to traverse the fortified Cotentin Peninsula, clearing the way for tens of thousands of troops that would be parachuting and dropped by gliders. Looking at the map here, you can understand more of the logistics of this aggressive mission. The taking of Cherbourg and its deep water port was their goal. Without a commercial port, it was thought that the war could not be won. Hitler declared Cherbourg a Festung, or fortress. He ordered that it was to be defended to the last bullet of the last soldier standing. By his orders, 20 oppressive pillboxes were constructed, armed with the deadly 88-millimeter cannons called 88s, the most feared weapon of World War II, except for the atom bomb. Augie's main objective was to take out those pillboxes. In our story, the segment of these encounters is thrilling. During the approach to their destination on June 19th, a 100-year storm brought torrential rains and epic flooding, making this task even more difficult. The details that were uncovered by a formerly classified report received from the Army tell the Army's blow-by-blow accounts that followed these 66,000 infantrymen to cut off and surround 60,000 German soldiers. Read them all at Cranford86.org. On June 22nd, an ultimatum of surrender or be crushed went unanswered, and the onslaught began. Then on the 23rd, strikes from carrier-based fighters approached the area. Flares were set off to mark the troops' placement, but the winds from the storm caused the smoke markers to dissipate quickly. Many friendly bombs were dropped on Augie's unit, causing many casualties. Some family members feel that this is where Augie lost his life. Although with all the violent actions of that day, it was hard to be certain. 1 week later, Cherbourg was under control of the Allies. It was the biggest victories of the up to that point in the war, and set a positive tone for the rest of the war to come. 40,000 prisoners were taken. We have a picture of the prisoners walking out of the town. Hitler was calling the commander officer a coward for his surrender. Back at home, a telegram courier arrived at 10 Meeker Avenue. It was the second time sad news was delivered by Western Union. Just 2 months earlier, the Delisandruses received word that Augie's brother, Alfred, and his B-17 bomber were missing over Germany. He was believed to have been held at a prisoner of war camp. Augie was buried temporarily in France, but was moved to Beverly National Cemetery in New Jersey. A large Cranford turnout attended the day to commemorate Augie's life and to mourn the Delisandruses' family's loss. Augie Delisandro was only 23 years old. The romantic story of Natalia and Pietrini Delisandris and their immigration from Italy and the patriotic pride that they instilled in each one of their children makes an incredible story and worth reading. I hope you do. Special thanks go out to the Cranford Women's Club for sponsoring Augie Delisandris' banner. It will fly above the downtown streets of Cranford that he loved so much for many years to come. Thanks so much for listening to our story. And stick around, there'll be more stories of Cranford 86 profiles coming up later in the day. Hello, Don Sweeney coming to you again with another profile of a Cranford 86 hometown hero. While the names of our hometown heroes were engraved on Memorial Park tablets many years ago, with complete respect to their service and ultimate sacrifice, their identities, once known to the town people of their time, now, for the people living here today, their identities are mostly unknown. Our project's mission is to introduce their faces and their stories to the Cranford residents of today and tomorrow. Their time in Cranford was interrupted by a war that they had no part in creating. They just answered a call to defend their country that they loved and were never able to return to enjoy the freedom that they helped create. So let me introduce you to one of them, Seaman First Class Friend Burton. Friend Burton was just another Cranford kid like you see around town every day. He had an unusual first name, being named after Dr. Friend, the physician that delivered him into this world. The family has no other explanation. As a junior in Cranford High in 1941, when Pearl Harbor was attacked, his plans for the future, like many other Cranford kids' plans, changed drastically. Over 60% of the boys and many of the girls from his graduating class joined the armed services. Even before his graduation, Friend joined the Navy, becoming a plank owner, that being the first crew of the USS Brain, a Fletcher-class destroyer. a lightweight, fast ship built to protect other slower ships, such as aircraft carriers and battleships. Its defense by thick metal walls being traded for its speed and nimble maneuvering. It also contained sensitive detection equipment like radar and sonar that many other ships did not have. In August of 1943, Burton and the 300 crew member of the Brain headed south from Boston to journey to the Pacific through the Panama Canal. En route, they encountered a violent hurricane that almost sunk her. A baptism by fire for the rookie crew. They sustained serious damage and had to spend time in Jamaica for repairs. Our written story documents a year of exciting travels with a historic detail. I recommend you read them all. The stories are thrilling and will make your heart beat quickly. Okinawa was the last island to be taken on the way to mainland Japan. Kamikaze attacks were the newest threat from a decimated Japanese Navy. During this time, 500-pound flying bombs were falling like rain on our fleet. Hundreds of ships fell victim to them. Defending against them was our Navy's most perplexing problem of the day. The episodes on May 27th attack are the most thrilling. Stu Rosenthal was able to get eyewitness accounts of the details as two kamikaze planes struck the Brain within 2 minutes of each other. It set the 376-foot ship ablaze and spinning wildly with wounded men falling into the shark-infested Pacific. It took 2 hours to extinguish the flames and bring it under control. Afterward, 67 men were reported missing. Friend Burton sadly was one of them. He was just 20 years old. On June 22nd, the island of Okinawa was secured. 36 ships, including 12 destroyers, had been sunk. 12,500 men were lost, 49,000 wounded. The Brain and its remaining crew was ordered back to Boston, and it limped there over many days for its complete overhaul. 2 years after she left to the day, she arrived back in Boston Harbor. Ironically, the same day that the first atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, followed by 2 days later, another bomb at Nagasaki. On August 14th, World War II was over. Left behind on 29 Elizabeth Avenue were his mother and father, John and Brenda, and his siblings, Mary and Kenneth. Kenneth's children, Catherine Falzerano and Dr. Friend Burton, were in contact with us through the entire research and writing process. We were very honored to be given this amazing 48-star flag that was presented to the Burton family at the Military Memorial Service. It flew over the Brain for much of its 2-year service, and it has many battle scars and burns. We've received permission to display this on the wall of our council chambers at City Hall, and we thank Dr. Friend Burton for providing it for us. Special thanks also go out to Dan DeWeaver, a resident of Elizabeth Avenue, for sponsoring Friend's banner and for helping us with the research. We thank you so much for listening to our stories today. Stay tuned, more stories of Cranford 86 from the 2020 honorees will follow. And don't forget to go on cranford86.org and find out how to get your own book, where you can leave it on your coffee table for people to see throughout the year. And as many people are doing, ordering them for Father's Day presents is maybe a nice idea. Thanks again. Hello again. It's Don Sweeney with another profile of a Cranford 86 hometown hero. Unlike so many heroes that have been profiled so far, this hero did not die on a battlefield or on the open seas. Like many Cranford 86 heroes, he died by accident or an illness while in service to his country. Such is the case throughout history. More than 50% of Civil War soldiers whose name appear on bronze plaques across our nation died from non-combat circumstances like dysentery. 30% of our own Cranford World War I heroes listed on our memorial monument fell during wartime to the flu epidemic of 1918. The patriotism, courage, and character of these men were evident in their intentions, even though their intentions did not become reality. They are owed our thanks and gratitude. Their lives were no less valuable or loss any easier to bear to their loved ones. Hence, our respect of their service is no less than the heroes killed in action. Let me introduce you to Naval Cadet Harold L. Johnson from World War II. Harold was an academically gifted young man, a mathematical wizard, the kind of kid that solves mathematical problems for fun. As a freshman in 1938, he entered the brand newly constructed Cranford High School as one of the first classes to do so. When the Japanese Imperial Navy attacked Pearl Harbor in his senior year, Harold had already been accepted to attend Lehigh University in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, one of America's elite engineering schools. After graduation, he did just that. While there, he attended an Army recruitment event for the highly selected V1 program that finds students like him for training in high-tech military positions. He was accepted and enrolled in the program with the hopes of becoming a naval aviator. At this point, he was an official naval cadet. He returned to his family home at 9 Herning Avenue in Cranford in January for his first semester break, officially as a member of the armed forces, only to come home again the following month in February with an unexplained high fever. He was diagnosed with lymphatic leukemia. Today, it would be known as Hodgkin's disease. At that time, there was no effective treatment for it. They treated him with radiation and blood transfusion, but sadly, in 2 weeks, he died at Elizabeth General Hospital. He was just 18 years old. Dedicating his life to service to his country's defense gave Harold status as a member of Cranford 86. Harold was survived by parents Harold and Astrid and two younger siblings, Robert and Edward. We were in touch with the youngest Edward, now living in Livingston, throughout the research and writing of Harold's story. He provided much of the facts shared in this profile. We hope you all will go to Cranford86.org and pay tribute to his memory by reading his story. In Indian Village, or Sunny Acres section of our town, Harold Johnson Place was named in his honor. It can be found next to the streets of Roger Norton and Alan O'Kell, both one of our Cranford 86 heroes. John Bowles, a resident of Harold Johnson Place, sponsored Harold's banner that will be displayed downtown after Memorial Day. Thanks so much for spending time with us for the Cranford 86 stories. Stick around, there'll be one more coming. Hello, it's Don Sweeney from the Cranford 86 Project with another profile of a Cranford 86 hometown hero. Before I begin to tell you about our next hero, I'd like to give a shout out to our amazing team of writers, researchers, and proofreaders. Stu Rosenthal, a former Air Force high-tech officer, is our researcher. Right now, he is working on several heroes' files for developing stories for the future. He is responsible for most of the facts that we use to create these stories and for finding family members all over the country that we're able to interview. Without his skills and determination, these stories could not be told. He also was a skilled writer and proofreader. He took the lead in writing the profile of Gene McCary, a naval pilot from World War II just last year. Janet Ashnault, a family member of Cranford 86 hero Ray Ashnault, has moved from proofreader to be my co-writer. Where I am the storyteller, Janet makes my stories seem readable. If you think our profiles are well written, then this is a compliment to her. As a Cranford 86 family member, Janet is our sensitivity filter. She makes sure that we do not overstep our depictions of violence, reminding us that Cranford 86 loved ones many times are our readers. Vic Barry, a decorated Vietnam hero himself, looks over every profile before it goes to print to make sure our words conform with military speak. Vic is the curator of Cranford Historical Society. Having a literary degree, he also plays a key role as an expert proofreader. Together, this team dedicates hundreds of hours each year to document the life stories of the Cranford 86 that you read in the paper each month. We do appreciate your consistent positive comments that we receive throughout the year. They give us fuel to continue our work. Please continue to send those comments. We appreciate them. Now let me introduce you this year's final Cranford 86 hero, SP5 Marcus P. Anderson, Army Engineer, Vietnam War. Marcus Anderson is the first Cranford 86 hero that served in the Army Corps of Engineers. That fact intrigued us, as well as the fact that his home is just doors down from where Stu Rosenthal has raised his family. In Vietnam, the job of an engineer was exceedingly difficult. Building a network of highways across jungles infested with Viet Cong and the mines meant to kill or maim soldiers made for an unbelievably treacherous work. Stu was able to find two of Mark's brothers. They were able to paint a picture for us of an amazing, caring, and compassionate young man. I hope each of you will find time to read the accounts that we were able to gather. We found that John Dreyer of Dreyer's Farms played high school football with Mark. John's wife, Martha, is friends to this day with Evie, Mark's only girlfriend. They all shared with us that Mark entered the service solely to protect his younger brother, Larry, from the draft. In fact, after completing his first tour of duty in 1968, Mark enlisted to continue that protection, an amazing act of kindness. In August of 1968, while working on a highway in South Vietnam, a passing construction vehicle struck an underground mine and killed Mark instantly. He was 2 months short of his discharge date. He was just 21 years old. A military report was uncovered by Stu Rosenthal about failure of their mine sweeping devices. Sadly, only 15 of their 40 units were working due to water damage from the monsoon rains. Another man from his unit died in similar fashion that same month. It would seem that they were both due to construction jobs continuing without the proper safety equipment. This type of things happens many times in the Army, we're told by Vic Berry. This story contains so much connection to Mark's life and activities in Cranford. Never before have we had conversations with siblings and a girlfriend, as we did for this profile. The fond description of their exclusive double dates at the canoe club, the clay courts, or to destination dates at Olympic Park for Dime Day, and of course, the boardwalk at Point Pleasant, they're precious. They're memories of New Jersey in a simpler time. The saddest news uncovered was the letter to Evie's dad, written by Mark. In it, Mark asked permission to marry his Evie upon his return, a return that would never happen. Evie had no idea about this letter until after Mark's death. It was one of those moments that makes the hair stand up on my arm. Special thanks go out to Tim Harrington for sponsoring the banner of Marcus Anderson that flies above the streets of Cranford. This story, along with the other 26, are online at cranford86.org, and in both our Cranford 86 books available by calling 908-272-0876. In closing, we'd like to thank the many families and organizations that have sponsored the hero banners that now fly over the streets of Cranford. We encourage future sponsors to contact us to help our project to continue. Special thanks also go out to Rena Media for printing every word and picture submitted to them each month, and to the Cranford JCs for covering our ever-growing research expenses, and to the Cranford Public Works Department that displays our Cranford 86 banners around town. Without them, our banner program would not exist. And we'd like to thank you for listening and reading our stories about the Cranford 86 hometown heroes. Again, to purchase our books, we have two, a 40-page volume 3 with the 6 stories from this year, and then we have a full collection of 27 stories and a 128-page book, volume 1 through 3. And you can get them by emailing us at info@cranford86.org or calling the number 908-272-0876. The cost of the books is just to cover the printing expenses. The books are really beautiful. We hope that you give us a call. And we thank you for being part of Cranford 86 and sponsoring our program.